before we get there, I want to read something out of Ephesians chapter 5 as an introduction. So in Ephesians chapter 5, 15, it says this: "See then that you walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time because the days are evil." This encouragement, this exhortation is meant for us to be very aware of our circumstances, of our environment, of the things around us, because it says the days are evil. So this was written roughly 2,000 years ago. The history of man has been a history of evil in the world. We're not now necessarily more evil than, say, in the Roman Empire or the days of Sodom and Gomorrah or the days of Noah with the flood, but we're probably pretty close. The point is, as Christians living in this world, it's so important to understand how we are to travel and to take these exhortations seriously, because they're not written just randomly as a poetic form in Paul's letters. They're written as one who is greatly concerned, because he understands, like Jesus does and like God sees, he understands what this world is all about and what it means to be a Christian in this world. So redeem the time, walk circumspectly, because the days are evil. Now back in our text in Psalm 104, in the past couple weeks, we've been looking at these scriptures in a way of how to journey or how to travel, how to get from here to there. One of my favorite stories in the New Testament is when Jesus took his disciples in the boat to cross over the sea, and he was asleep, and the great storm came, and they were all freaked out, and they said, "We're perishing." And Jesus sort of rebuked them after he calmed the storm. And he said that it was their faith that was a problem, because Jesus said they were going to get to the other side. So if you're a Christian, you're going to get to the other side. The key is how you get there. Are we going to get there victoriously, triumphantly? Are we going to get there fruitfully? Are we going to get there trusting the Lord? Because he said we're going to get there, so we are. Now, storms have a tendency to make us freak out. The exhortation here in the next couple chapters is to teach us, to remind us, to focus us about the importance of how we're to live in these times. Now, in chapter 104, we're calling this a time to rejoice. And if you'll notice, if you'll turn and look at verse 33 of that same chapter, it says, "I will sing to the Lord." How long? As long as I live. "I will sing praise to my God while I have my being." So one thing we gather from that is getting from here to there, the process, the in-between, is a time to rejoice. Because he says, my life, what it's going to be about, what I'm going to involve myself in, is praising the Lord and singing to him. Now, here's the hard part. So is it bad to be sad? We know it's not bad to be sad. The Bible says, blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Here's the thing. We're human beings, right? We get sad. Jesus, did he get sad? Yeah, he got sad. Don't beat yourself up about being sad, but know that there's a way not to be sad. And there's a way we can even hurt and grieve and mourn, yet at the same time rejoice. It's a weird thing, isn't it? I don't know exactly how that works, but I know that is possible. I know that in our hearts they could be sad, but at the same time we could be rejoicing in the Lord. So rejoice. This is time to rejoice. Now this whole chapter is explaining how we can rejoice. You may say, well, my life is not a life where I can rejoice about things. Well, we would have to answer to Paul about that, who said, rejoice in the Lord. Again, I say, rejoice. He said that in Philippians chapter 4, where he is in prison. So we have to answer to Paul. If we say that we don't have any reason to rejoice, we'd have to answer to Paul. We'd also have to answer the fact that the fruit of the Spirit is love and joy. So how does this all work? Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. That means when we get to the brokenness of ourself, we enter into the blessedness of the Lord. So broken to self is blessedness to the Lord. Now, before we begin, rejoice, that word rejoice, re means basically repeat. So we're to joy repeatedly. Repeated joy. Now, just think when Paul, when he says that in Philippians 4, he says, rejoice in the Lord. He says it twice, right? So that means, like, we're to be rejoicing. And I just noticed we don't have the clock anymore. I didn't bring my watch. So if somebody could let me know when it's like 15 after, that'd be great. So let all of us, no matter where we are, what's going on, it's a time to rejoice in what? Let's take a look. So, bless the Lord, O my soul. O Lord, my God, you are very great. The emphasis on God's greatness then is a cause for celebration, especially when his greatness meets our weakness. So a great God deserves great blessing. A great God deserves praise and worship that is great. And when our incompleteness and our weakness comes to meet his greatness, then now we're on our way to rejoicing. So he says, bless the Lord, O my soul, O Lord my God, you are very great. You are clothed with honor and majesty. And then he goes down and basically refers to the days of creation, the 7 days of creation. So notice he says in verse 2, he says, speaking about God. Notice his whole focus now is on God, especially in his creative abilities. He says, who cover yourself with light as with a garment. In the beginning of God's creation, he first said, let there be light on day one. He says, you stretch out the heavens like a curtain. Verse 3 says, he lays beams of his upper chambers in the waters, who makes the clouds his chariot, who walks on the wings of the wind, who makes his angels spirits, his ministers a flame of fire. So the creative aspects of God and who he is reflective in what he has done in his creation. So the writer now is being swept away with his understanding of the greatness of God, which is exemplified in his creation. And so on day two, we just saw day two exemplified in his creation of the atmosphere. So in verse 5, he says, you who laid the foundations of the earth so that it should not be moved forever, you covered it with the deep as with a garment. The waters stood above the mountains. At your rebuke, they fled. So picture this whole scene going on. And picture God. I picture him kind of like a orchestra leader, just dictating all these creative events. And in Job chapter 38, verse 7, it says that the angels were actually making music while God was doing all this. So it's like God was in his workshop and he was creating all these things, the heavens and the earth and all that's within it. Day one, the light, and day two, the atmosphere. And then he starts to create the vegetation and the water. And then he starts to organize and orchestrate where the water is supposed to be. Look at verse 7. He says, at your rebuke they fled, speaking about the water. At the voice of your thunder they hastened away. They went up over the mountains. They went down into the valleys to the place which you founded for them. You have set a boundary that they may not pass over, and that they may not return to cover the earth. Because, of course, in the beginning when he created all these great things, then 71% of the earth is water. And so God put the water in its special, specific places. And within that, then we discover that God actually has put boundaries in place so the whole earth doesn't flood. So as we start to look at creation, which is really a fingerprint of God, I would encourage you to get into astronomy or horticulture or anything that kind of, you can kind of look at how things are, because it'll draw you closer to God. It's absolutely fascinating to do that. So he says in verse 10, he says, he sends the springs into the valleys. They flow among the hills. They give drink to every beast of the field. The wild donkeys quench their thirst. By them, the birds of heaven have their home, and they sing among the branches. The waters of he waters the hills from his upper chambers. The earth is satisfied with the fruit of your work. So it's as he's created everything, we find also that not only is God a creative genius, but then God is also sustaining everything. He's also nurturing everything. And then he's created things so efficiently that they all work sort of together in harmony to supply and support one another. So the water supply is supporting the animals, and he's going to go on and describe more of that. But as you start to understand and start to realize how amazing God's creation is, it, to me, it just makes the whole idea of evolution so much more absurd. Because with evolution, and with the teaching of evolution, which is, by the way, is a theory, it starts without God. You will never get to a place of resolution because you will never truly find a source for all creation. So you can't have a creation without a creator. You can't have something without something that made it. This is just something a child would understand. This is something that's very easy and simple, obvious. But you know, when we ignore the fact of a creator, an eternal creator, and then we try to explain the creation, then we're always going to find a point where we stop or get stuck because we never know where the stuff came from. The only way we can know where the stuff came from is to hear from the only one that was there. So nobody was there except for God. Here we have an incredible description of how everything got here. You start with God, you start with an eternal being, God, who had no beginning and no ending, and one who is able to do all these things. And you work from that point on, then everything makes sense. Because you're starting from the starting point. You're starting from the only thing that makes sense. But the intricacies of creation, and you start to see how things are so dependent and reliant upon each other, you start to realize that just the tilting of the earth is so important. Just the rotation of the earth is so important. The distance of the earth to the sun is so important. These things get off a little bit and we don't survive anymore. Then you start talking about the gravitational pulls and he's going to talk about that, the moon and the sun and all that stuff. All you can really do if you're honest in your heart is stand back and praise the Lord. Because you start to realize this creation goes beyond a scientific experiment. This goes beyond anything that man could fathom or comprehend. It is absolutely mind-blowing. You go back and read these verses tonight, and you just picture God doing all these things, and you put yourself right next to him when he's doing all these things, and you just, there's no movie better than this. There's nothing compared to the glory of God's creation. So he says in verse 14, something I find interesting, he says, he causes. That's an important word because God is a cause. So God is intentionally, purposefully causing the grass to grow for the cattle. So you know what that means, why that's important, is because it's not saying that God got the earth going and just left it to itself. It's saying that he is involved in every happening of the earth, that without God there would be nothing happening. So he's actively involved in these processes. It says, and the vegetation for the service of man. So that was the third day of creation, whereas the oceans and the vegetation and the dry land. So look at end of verse 14. It says that he may bring forth food from the earth. Now, isn't that interesting? So you have all these things going on, and God made it. Think about this. He made it so man has to be dependent on him. Do you see that? He made us that in order to survive, we have to eat and drink. In order to eat and drink, we have to rely on God's provision for that, don't we? So whenever there is a famine or something like that in the land, people would be so desperate because we can't just whip up something and make something without the things to make it. So whether we like it or not, or whether someone wants to deny God or not, we are absolutely 100% dependent on God every day, every minute of every hour, and he made it that way. We are completely dependent on God's provision. So in verse 15, he says then, and the wine that makes glad the heart of man, the oil to make his face shine, the bread which strengthens man's heart. The trees of the Lord are full of sap. The cedars of Lebanon, which he planted, where the birds make their nests. See how efficient he is? That's cool. So he's making trees, and then there's sap, and then there's birds in the tree that live in these trees. It's just the efficiency of the Lord. I love that. And then in verse 17, the stork has made her home in the fir trees. The high hills are for the wild goats. The cliffs are for refuge for the rock badgers. He appointed the moon. This is the fourth day of creation, the sun and the moon and the stars. He appointed the moon for seasons. Now we see that in God's creative genius, he's also a God of order, isn't he? So how the moon works and the gravitational pull and then the rotation of the earth, the tilting of the axis, the distance from the sun, and all this, now we have seasons. Unless we live in California, then we don't. But we have seasons, right? Things are predictable. You know what that tells us? That tells us that God is a God, an organized God. But you know what it also tells us? That we have this constant reminder of when spring comes, of new life, new things. Summer comes, those tend to die out, and then fall, things change again, and then winter, and then we do it all over again. It's been doing that since God created. It's this constant reminder to us. The seasons are that this is all heading somewhere. This is all going somewhere. Robert Frost's poem about the green that disappears and fades. I can't remember exactly how it goes, but that poem talks about how Eden sinks to its grave and how new life comes. It's a reminder of what's ahead for us. It's a reminder of how cyclical life is. It's a reminder of God's newness and his freshness and the frailty of life here, that things are here and gone in a moment. He built that all in for us. So people say, show me God. Why doesn't God just show me himself, right? Why didn't you just, if you're real God, just do something? And all around us is a constant reminder, if we just care to look, if we just care to look, there are miracles of God's working all around us constantly. So in verse 19, he appointed the moon for seasons. The sun knows it's going down. You make darkness and it's night, in which all the beasts of the forest creep about. The young lions roar in their prey, after their prey, and they seek their food from God. When the sun rises, they gather together and they lie down in their dens. That's why zoos are kind of a bummer, because you go to the zoo and all the cool animals are just laying there all the time. Isn't that cool? God made nocturnal animals. So it's like a signal to them when night comes to be active. And then when the sun goes down, to go to sleep. Isn't that just wild? In God has set like a time clock, even in the animals, where they know. These things we may call them instincts. But these are things that God wired them to be like that. And it's important for us to never dismiss these things and not go past what we see in the creation and the tendencies and just look at that. But the point is that we would see all these things and they would point to our Creator. We don't worship the creation, we worship the Creator of the creation. Now remember, the context of this is living in this time in the earth when we see all these things going on, it's a time to rejoice. We have a lot of reminders to rejoice. All these things we talked about are constant reminders. When you walk outside tonight and you see the moon and the stars, that's a reminder, rejoice. God's in control. God's sustaining. Everything is going somewhere. God is true to his word. All these things, these constant reminders to us, don't miss out on those things. So he says in verse 22, he says, When the sun rises, they gather together and they lie down in their dens. Verse 23, man goes out to do his work and to his labor until evening. And so that was the fourth day of creation. The fifth day of the creation is the fish and the birds. So he says, O Lord, how manifold are your works. In wisdom you have made them all. The earth is full of your possessions. This great and wide sea, in which are innumerable teeming things, living things, both small and great. There the ships sail about. There is that Leviathan, which is a giant sea creature, which you have made to play there. These things all wait for you, that you may give them their food in due season. So God's even responsible for feeding the fish life. And he says, you give them what you give them, they gather in, you open your hand, and they are filled with good. The sixth day was God creating the man and the animals. You hide your face, and they are troubled. See how dependent they are on God? If God doesn't give it to them, they're not getting it. You hide your face, and they are troubled. You take away their breath. They die and return to dust, to their dust. You send forth your spirit. They are created. And you renew the face of the earth. So, of course, on the seventh day, God rested. So now may the glory of the Lord endure forever. May the Lord rejoice in his works. He looks on the earth and it trembles. He touches the hills and they smoke. And then here's what we started with. So with all of this, our response to that, I will sing to the Lord as long as I live. The whole point is to have a perspective of the greatness of God and to put our life in perspective, connected to God's greatness, and to understand and know that is the cause for rejoicing. I will sing, verse 33, I will sing to the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praise to my God while I have my being. May my meditation be sweet to him. I will be glad in the Lord. Now this is cool because obviously there are some deep thoughts going on about God. And as he's having these incredible deep thoughts about God, he's praying, let the meditations, the things I think about, let them be pleasing to God. Let my mind be consumed with God things is what he's saying. He says, I will be glad in the Lord. Verse 35, he says, may sinners be consumed from the earth and the wicked be no more. And then he finishes off, he says, bless the Lord, O my soul, praise the Lord. So now now we've learned and saw that to have these kind of thoughts, it takes a very purposeful and focused mind. And oftentimes this is where we get off track. The encouragement is to know that our life now, the beauty of it, one of the things that we are given as Christians is the opportunity to see the deep things of God, to meditate on them, to celebrate them, and to rejoice in them. So it's going to take a very concentrated effort of our mind to do this. The second thing in this next chapter is life on earth is also not only a time to remember, it's a time to follow. So crucial that we understand as we're thinking about God, then our thoughts grow feet. And we begin to follow the Lord, walking with the Lord. So in this life, it's a time to follow. So he gives this whole chapter about following the Lord. He says, oh, give thanks to the Lord and call upon his name. So I don't know if it was last week or the week before we talked about how long it would take to be world-class givers of thanks to the Lord. 416 days, I think we said, which is November 8th next year, something like that. I put it in my calendar. So my question is, how are we doing with that? We're like a week or two in. Are we getting good at giving thanks to the Lord? As we start to think these things, remember the time on earth, our time from here or there, is a time to be giving thanks to the Lord. As we meditate on the Lord, as we see the Lord, as we understand his goodness, we have thousands of reasons to give thanks to the Lord, and they're all right around us, in front of us. I just want to encourage you to look for them and start thanking the Lord for them. He says in verse 1, the second part, he says, make known the deeds among the peoples. And it's kind of what we're doing here, is we're talking about what God has done. That's another crucial part of our life, is making God's deeds known. Verse 2, he says, sing to him, sing psalms to him, talk of all his wondrous works, glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those rejoice who seek the Lord. Seek the Lord and his strength. Seek his face evermore. Remember his marvelous works which he has done, his wonders and the judgments of his mouth. So that's a crucial verse. You might want to circle or underline that. Because in that verse he's saying, we are to remember the marvelous works of the Lord. So it's sort of a challenge for us sitting here today to ask ourselves, are we remembering all the works of the Lord? Is that something in our mind constantly, of what God has done, how he's working in a global way, in a universal way, in a biblical way, but also in our own lives? Think back about how God has worked in our life specifically and individually. That's very important. So he says, remember these things about God. And he says in verse 6, now he's going to explain through the nation of Israel what God has done for them. He said, O seed of Abraham, his servant, you children of Jacob, his chosen ones, he is the Lord our God. His judgments are in all the earth. He remembers his covenant. How long? Forever. God doesn't forget his covenant. That's important, because the children of Israel, he has given a covenant, the Abrahamic covenant. And God will continue to work with the nation of Israel eternally. So he says in verse 11, to you I will give the land of Canaan as the allotment of your inheritance. When they were few in number, indeed very few, and strangers in it. So God gave them the land in Canaan. So that's why there's so much arguing and fighting over the land in Israel. Because here we have specifically stated that the land has been given by God to the Jews. When they went from one nation to another, verse 13, from one kingdom to another people, he permitted no one to do them wrong. He rebuked kings for their sake, saying, do not touch my anointed one, and do my prophets no harm. He was divinely protecting his people, just as he is right now, divinely protecting the nation of Israel. Verse 16, moreover, He called for a famine in the land. He destroyed all the provision of bread. He sent a man before Joseph, who was sold as a slave. And they hurt his feet with fetters, and he was laid in iron. So this land that God gave them, he's recounting how the nation of Israel actually ended up getting the land. And so we have this focus on Joseph, who was sold into slavery, ended up as a slave in Egypt, and ended up rising to power and bringing his family out, and that's how they ended up in Egypt, until the king changed, and the king didn't like the Jews because they're growing, getting too powerful, so they made them slaves. After many years, 400 years of slavery, they cried out to the Lord, and God raised up Moses to deliver them out of Egypt and take them into the promised land. The short summary. So he says in verse 19, until the time that his word came to pass, the word of the Lord tested him. And you know, that scripture, out of all my studying through these chapters, that's the one that stood out the most to me. Because he's saying, until the time that his word came to pass, the word of the Lord tested him. That's very interesting. Because God had given a promise to Joseph. You may have heard of the coat of many colors. And he was the youngest brother at the time. And his father said, or actually he had a dream that he would rise above all his brothers and rule over them. And what happened is he ended up in a pit. And then he ended up in jail. But you see here, this is so important to get. This really ministered to my heart, because God's word will come to pass. And in our life, we may be in those times where we're feeling in the pits or feeling stuck or feeling imprisoned or feeling like the promises of God haven't really come to fruition in our life. But there's something happening. And the waiting time, he's saying it's a time of testing, that the word of the Lord is testing us, meaning it's getting us ready for those promises and those dreams and those things to come to be. So there's a scriptural principle here that's so important. That these times of waiting are very needed and purposeful, because it's preparing us for what's coming next. Don't ever try to skip steps in the Christian life. Don't try to transport yourself or play leapfrog. But God is so efficient in how he uses everything in our life to prepare us for the next thing. That's exactly what he did with Joseph. In verse 20, it says, the king sent and released him. The ruler of the people let him go free. He made him lord of his house and ruler of all his possessions. So that's just a real quick summary of Joseph being so unfairly treated, unjustly treated, being stuck, nothing he can do, accused of trying to commit adultery with Pharaoh's wife and all these things against him. But none of those things could have affected God's plan for his life. God wasn't going to allow that to happen. So important for us to know that. So in verse 21, he made him lord of his house and ruler over all his possessions, to bind his princes at his pleasure and teach his elders wisdom. Israel also came to Egypt, and Jacob dwelt in the land of Ham. He increased his people greatly and made them stronger than their enemies. He turned their heart to hate his people, to deal craftily with his servants. Now, you can't miss God's working in all these situations. Imagine how many angles God's working, and many of those things are being done without anybody really quite realizing what was going on. It's one of the neat things about following the Lord, which is what we're talking about in this chapter, is that when we follow the Lord the best we can with the revelation that we have and the knowledge that we have, we get caught up in this whole matrix, if you will, of activity, of all these different things that God's working out from all these different angles to bring about His will and His plan, oftentimes unsuspected by us. The key is to keep following the Lord, even though we don't understand and we can't see exactly what's going on. So that's what 25 was about, verse 25. He turned their heart to hate His people. So God's working even from different angles to make the king of Egypt hate the Egyptians and put them into slavery, which also would lead to their dramatic release years later. So in verse 26, He sent Moses, His servant, and Aaron, Moses' brother, whom He had chosen, and they performed His signs among them, and wonders in the land of Ham. He sent darkness, and He made it dark, and they did not rebel against His word. That's the key. He turned the waters into blood, and He killed their fish. So He's speaking about God's judgment on the Egyptians. You know, the let my people go thing where Moses went to Pharaoh and he said he wouldn't, and God would bring a series of 10 plagues upon him. Their land abounded with frogs, even in the chambers of their kings. He spoke, and there came swarms of flies and lice in all the territory. He gave them hail for rain and flaming fire in their land. He struck their vines also and their fig trees, and He splintered the trees of their territory. He spoke, and locusts came, young locusts without number, and ate up all the vegetation in their land and devoured the fruit of their ground. I love this because when we put ourselves in a position of following the Lord, it may not look like we have a lot of resources or the things that people often think we need to be successful. But God has, He doesn't need us, and He doesn't necessarily need a whole bunch of stuff. He has a lot of stuff at His disposal. He can use lice and just make lice go on. He can cover the land with frogs and young locusts, and that's pretty cool. So God has His ways, and His ways are above our ways. And so that's why we can just follow. That's why we can just put ourselves in a position of following the Lord. So in verse 36, it says, He also destroyed all the firstborn in the land, the first of all their strength. He also brought them out with silver and gold, and there was none feeble among His tribes, so that He sustained their strength. Egypt was glad when they departed. I bet. For the fear of them had fallen upon them. You think? He spread a cloud for covering and a fire to give light in the night. The people asked, and He brought quail, and He satisfied them with the bread of heaven. He opened the rock, and water gushed out. It ran in the dry places like a river. So now, upon their release, God is supernaturally providing for them. See, do you think God only did that then? Do you think God can do that now? He does. The thing is, and that's the key to following the Lord, sometimes because we have a lot of resources, we keep going to the goodie bag. And we don't just trust the Lord and follow him to the place where we say, okay, Lord, if it's going to be, it's got to be you. And if it's not you, then don't let me take steps of my own desire and my own will. That's where this gets really important. And sometimes it's harder for us because we do have resources, and it's easy to mistake throwing resources at something than following the Lord. And that's why none of us are 100% on this. This is hard because we're constantly trying to decipher our will from God's will. Our feelings and our emotions get involved in everything. And so I just want to encourage you to be just really aware of your life and the importance, to the best that you know how, of just following the Lord step by step, not before him, not behind him, but in sync with him. When we do that, it's interesting. The natural takes on the supernatural. And I have found that in many of just the everyday, normal, natural things, if we just do the natural things, God will add the super to it. And we start to get an understanding that there's a life that God asks us to live that's lived by faith. And that life that's lived by faith, here's the thing. We're just going to finish with this chapter, by the way. I'm getting a lot of signals. Thank you for the signals. The life that we live by faith, it starts with us just saying to the Lord, God, I want to live like that. And I ask that you would help me to be very conscientious and aware of what your will is. And you know, sometimes there's going to be some painful no's and disappointments when your will, my will, when it's denied. We don't like that. I don't like that. It hurts. But when we say no to our will, at the same time we're saying yes to God's will. So saying no to our will is not a negative. Saying no to our will is a positive, because saying no is saying yes. And as we learn to walk with the Lord, you know what happens is we can then start to rest in his plan, and knowing that he has this all kind of worked out for us, and it's a good thing. And we find that these messes that we have a tendency to make when we make our own decisions and fight for our rights and try to exercise our control and power, whatever we may have, we find that it only messes things up. But to know that God will lead us gently, perfectly, in his right timing, and provide the provisions and things, now we become responsible people, because we're doing God's word, and the things that we know we're getting really into, the things that we know we're supposed to do, we're getting really into those things. And now life takes on a whole nother spiritual dimension. And I think that's so important, because God didn't save us to be the same. He saved us to be different. And if I had to think, well, God saved me, filled me with this Holy Spirit, made me a new creation in Christ, but my life was exactly the same as it's ever been, and if God was taken out, it would still be the same, and if he was put in, it would still be the same, that would be very disappointing. But I know, according to God's word, that when we begin to follow the Lord like that, and this may be one of the most important things that we can learn as Christians. Because you remember in Ephesians 5, when it talked about redeeming the time and walking circumspectly, right after that it talked about don't be drunk with wine, but be filled with the Holy Spirit. So let's finish this before I get some more signals. For he, verse 42, after he talks about all these crazy neat things that God did, he says, for he remembered his holy promise. Isn't that neat? So after all this stuff, he talks about God's, he said, God remembered his promise. And he remembered Abraham, his servant. Guys, take comfort in that. God remembers you. He sees you. He knows what you're going through. He understands. He's remembering you. Verse 43, he brought out his people, what? With joy. His chosen ones with gladness. He gave them the lands of the Gentiles, and they inherited the labor of the nations, that they might observe his statutes and keep his laws. Everybody with me? Praise the Lord. Before you close your Bibles, do you see that last part? After all this dramatic working of God in the children of Israel, from Abraham to Joseph to Egypt to the plagues to leading them out, he did all that, and the end of all that was so they would follow the Lord. Did you see that? That they might observe his statutes and keep his laws. The whole working of God and our salvation then now is so that we would walk with God and follow him day in and day out. It's as simple as that. May God empower us by his Holy Spirit to follow him step by step. Amen.